Township Committee meeting to order, please.
Bonnie, would you please lead us in a flag salute?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Adequate notice of this meeting has been provided pursuant to the New Jersey Open Public Meetings Law by posting a notice on the bulletin board in the municipal building and by emailing a copy of the notice along with the agenda of this meeting to the Press of Atlantic City, Atlantic County Record, Record Journal, and current newspapers stating this meeting would take place at 6:30 p.m. on Monday, March 2nd, 2015, in the Municipal Building, Mays Landing, New Jersey. Ms. Gatto?
Here.
Mr. Gishard?
Present.
Mr. Kurtz?
Here.
Mrs. Link?
Here.
Mayor Silva?
Here. Take a moment of silence for private reflection. Okay, the first item is adjournment to executive session. We'll do that at the end of the meeting, and we may or may not come out and confirm anything if it's applicable at this time. Number three is the addition or deletion of late items for consideration tonight.
So moved.
Second.
A motion is second. Any questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carried. Okay, the first item on the agenda is discussions. Formal action may be taken. A is an ordinance amending section 2 or 3 of the Code of the Township of Hamilton regarding the establishment of a Historic Preservation Commission and provisions for the designation, preservation and regulation of historic landmarks and historic districts within the township, 1785-2015. If it is introduced tonight, the public hearing will be on March the 16th. Before we begin any discussion on committee, Michael, do we have people all signed up for it?
Jenny Ayers.
Okay, he'll call your names out. Obviously, we have
five.
Okay,
all
for the same thing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just introduce yourself and.
I'm please. Jenny Ayers. I live at Regent Circle. Former member of the HPC. I'm pleased to see that this is back on the agenda for an open and honest review of this process. But I must say, this is probably the most reviewed ordinance in the township. It has been reviewed at the HPC level, twice at the planning board, at which it was passed and sent to Trenton, reviewed by this committee, and now it's back for this committee. Since 2008, this process has been in place, and I'm really excited and hopeful that you will pass this and send it to yet another public meeting for discussion as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Michael?
Cheryl Fetty.
I'm here to address the request by the HPC for the introduction of the new ordinance for the HPC. Several years of research and time went into writing this ordinance with no cost to the township. Commission members wrote this following state and national guidelines as well as other CLG ordinances. We did this with the goal of becoming a certified local government. The benefit of becoming a certified local government is the availability of grant money from the State Office of Historic Preservation, which will benefit the historic district. And by the way, the state office approached our board and suggested we do this for the sake of getting grants. A lot of grant money is no match money. Also, most of the language in this ordinance applies to proposed historic district. Our historic district is already established and not proposing to expand. Our historic district and pocket sites have been on the National Register since 1987 or 88. The HPC was formed in 1979, so we have been around for over 30 years. We're not trying to reinvent the wheel. We just need to clarify our ordinance, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you.
James Kerrigan.
I can do my mic.
Stan Warner.
Good evening, Stan Weiner, 225 Lenape.
Yeah, I have to say, I just read through the documents like a lot of the people here. I don't have full understanding of them and don't claim to. I would just be, based on what I've read, against anything that's going to create this other whole hierarchy that gets in the way of development of our township. I certainly see the importance of historic designation. There are certain sites that should be protected against anything. But on the other side, I live in an area that's really becoming blighted, and I think a lot of homes that possibly could be historic should be encouraged to be torn down with new homes built. And I think it would help the whole area, it'd help the township's tax base. Certainly, you could establish criteria for what those homes should look like and design. But to establish another whole, like I'd like to see an advisory committee versus the entire thing that you know is up to be brought with this document. And there should always be that input there. But I would hate to be in a position where things get slowed down to a crawl because you know, you're applying for a permit to do something, and then they say, well, no, we don't want you to do this, and then you have to appeal to the planning board, and months can go by while you're waiting to do something as simple as put a new roof on. So it just concerns me, because even though everyone has good intentions, I know when you put people in a position of power, they can somehow sometimes forget what it is they were commissioned to do. And that's my only concern with this.
Good. Thank you for your comments.
Go ahead, Rodney. I ask a question of you. Sorry, your name was
Stan.
Stan? Yeah, just a question. You said you'd like to see a committee established, perhaps?
Well, committee that's advisory to the existing planning board.
All right. Well, the historic committee, isn't that what that is?
It's an advisory board.
The historic committee, the historic commission, is an advisory committee.
Exactly. But what I read, the establishment of this other document, or the document I read, would be a much more powerful group than just an advisory committee, correct?
Stuart?
Well, all they can provide is advice and recommendations. Hopefully they will be listened to, but they are an advisory committee.
Perhaps we could clarify
we
the
will.
Roles and
we
responsibilities
will.
When we have a discussion.
And hold that thought, too, because at the last meeting, the solicitor gave a presentation of his investigation of the entire document, and he spent a considerable amount of time with it. And obviously, what I'll ask him to do after the last speaker is to go through it again, if you don't mind, Mr. Solicitor, okay?
No.
I'd appreciate it. Who else is on there? Stuart, just stay for that, and we'll try to answer all the questions that you have arisen, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dan.
Mike?
Nelson Gaspar.
Nell?
Hello, everyone. Nelson Gaskell, 508 Farragut Avenue. I just got a couple questions, and I think maybe Cheryl already answered it. The zone is not going to be expanded any. It's going to stay within where it is now.
Go ahead, Bob, please.
And I mean, I can just say, okay.
The zone exists and has existed for a long time. Is it possible that the zone could expand as properties get older and become more historically significant? That is a possibility. At this point, you just heard Cheryl say it's not a probability. It's not something that's happening now.
That would be a concern of mine. And the other thing, some of what Stan said, I'm worried about with, you know, we're in such a bad home sales market and everything like that, making it more difficult. First of all, who's going to be the final decider, the advisory committee?
Planning board.
All right, because I'm worried about people selling homes to someone that doesn't know they're moving into a historic zone. They want to do a renovation or something, and it gets too costly for them because of all the historical things. Or someone that has an existing home, and the cost can be prohibitive, you know, if they have to put a special roof on or special color paint or do a different kind of woodwork, whatever it may be. So I'm concerned about that for that.
May I, Mayor?
Please, Kevin.
Nelson, this allows the grant process, which comes along with the certified local government status, to let both residents and the HPC apply for grants. So there would be some grant abilities available for residents that might not have the money to otherwise do the project.
That was...
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, John.
Thanks, Nelson. Mr. Solicitor, please.
John, do you know of someone who has applied for a grant to restore their home?
Actually applied for grants, but not with the HPC, because this new status just became available with this, with the status of a certified local government. So this ordinance allows that.
And if I'm not mistaken, I think when the letter came back from Trenton, they encouraged people to exactly do that, start looking at applying for grants, and they said it probably, if not this year, would definitely be available going forward next year. Okay, so, Bob?
With your permission, Mr. Mayor, may I stand over there?
Please, make it easy on yourself. It's like you're in a courtroom, huh?
Members of the Township Committee, ladies and gentlemen, I believe there has been a misperception of what this ordinance does and is intended to do. And I would even make the committee aware that I may have misspoken when I spoke at the last meeting. I meant to say it does not invest significant powers in an advisory board. And I may have said it does, but I made a mistake. I apologize. This ordinance has, well, first of all, we already have a historic preservation ordinance. We already have properties that are indexed as being historic landmarks. We have already created the historic district. Okay? So the properties that are affected are already listed in the inventory. So the extent that that could increase is possible, but not probable, as Ms. Fetty has said already tonight. I have reviewed this ordinance. Phil and I discussed this ordinance pretty much all day today. And I don't know how the misperception got started, but here's the issue. The first thing the ordinance does is provides a way for a property to get designated. This ordinance is more complete and provides more protection to people. Not less, more. It adds 8 additional criteria to make a property qualify. It sets forth the procedure as to how someone who wants to get their property designated or those who do not want it. It lays it out where the current ordinance does not. To my way of thinking, that provides more protection to people who own homes that may be historic, or the people that are in a historic district. It sets forth the procedure for anybody that's aggrieved. And the procedure has in it all of the due process and equal protections that you would expect. If someone wants to be designated, they submit a nomination. After the nomination is submitted, there's a public hearing before the HPC, a public hearing on notice to affected people. None of this is in the existing ordinance. It gives someone who wants to be designated or those who oppose the designation the right to submit evidence, the right to testify, either for or against. After that happens at the HPC level, the HPC has to submit a report. To whom? To the planning board. The planning board never loses control. The planning board then makes a review, again, a second public hearing on notice to the public in this room where everybody can hear it. And they send their recommendations to the governing body. The only way for a property to get added to the list or for the district to be expanded is by an ordinance of the governing body, which is the third level of public hearings. So that's how that happens. Now, the other thing that's important to bear in mind is this. If your property is designated as a landmark, or you live or own in the historic zone, and you want to modify your house, you want to put an addition on it, your business, your house, whatever it is, you have to make a presentation to HPC to apply for a certificate of appropriateness so that Hamilton Township can maintain its historic structures. Now, the example that I gave at the last meeting is this. Next to the bakery on Main Street is a building. I think it's a Beltel, is that what it is?
Verizon.
It's the ugliest building on Main Street. It doesn't fit. It shouldn't have been put there. I was told, I didn't live here then, that was once a beautiful single-family home. It got torn down for that we all look at with sandbags on the front door and no people going in and out of it. How did that happen? One of the intents of this is so that doesn't happen again. That places like downtown Mays Landing, which is beautiful, can remain historic. So, if you want to put on an addition, you make your application to the HPC for a certificate of appropriateness. If they give it to you, it goes to the planning board. The planning board never loses control. If your application is one that belongs in front of the zoning board of adjustment because you need a use variance, for example, you're increasing your density, the zoning board maintains control. Under this ordinance as written, the only way the HPC has any authority to issue a certificate of appropriateness is if the planning board lets them. It does one other thing. Well, it does many other things, but if your application is that you're a designated historic site in the Pineland Zone, it lays out in greater detail how you get what you want. Because the ordinance that's on the books now was from 2006. A lot of regulations have come back from Pineland since that time, 9 years. And by the way, this ordinance has been in the development process for 9 years. It updates all of the Pinelands issues. It does something else. If the chairman of the HPC believes that this is a minor application, that is, that there's no structural changes to the exterior of a designated property, he has the authority to say you don't need a certificate of appropriateness. Just one more added plus to the folks who own homes or businesses or structures or own property in the district. So I don't get this. I think that everything that's coming out of this is positive. At the last meeting, I said to the governing body, I said, you know, I have reviewed Cape May's ordinance. I grew up in Cape May. You talk about a success story for historic structures. Awesome. I've reviewed Haddonfield, Maplewood. I forget them all. And what I learned is they all started out as one thing. They started out as an idea, and they were changed, and they were modified, and they were amended repeatedly because they are living, breathing documents. And what I mean by that is it's kind of an analogy to the Constitution. You write words, and courts, through jurisprudence, interpret the words. Well, here you're creating a law with a laudable intent, not too different than the laws you have on the books right now. But it's going to have growing pains. It's going to have errors. And in one situation, it may not work. That's why we have a zoning board of adjustment. In other situations, it will work. You don't want people, Nelson, to tear down buildings of historical significance. We have it right now with the American Legion building. We're trying to salvage that. I remember when the township committee met in what is now the bank building, and it caught on fire. And what the bank did with that building was astonishing. It's a jewel in the middle of the town instead of an empty lot. And these are the kind of things that this, and I sound like I'm an advocate for this ordinance, and I'm not, but I think some people have gotten some bad information, and I think that Phil can add to it, certainly John can add to it, but I think in almost every respect that I've reviewed it, it's positive. Thank you.
Thank you. Phil, do you want to add anything, please?
Thank you, Mayor. Committee members, ladies and gentlemen, the one thing I'd like to add is that in looking at this ordinance, a lot of what's in there are specific requirements for performance by the Historic Commission. If you're reviewing an application, they have to act within so much time. This is the process that they have to follow, A, B, C, D, E. So that, you know, it's more to govern to make sure the commission operates the way it should rather than to put a restriction on a property owner. It also includes, in very specific language, I think, multiple levels of appeal if you're aggrieved by a decision. All, you know, I think it's commission action, then to planning board, then to the zoning official, and then to the zoning board of adjustment. So again, the idea is to make sure that the ultimate answer is the correct one. But those are the most important things coming out of it.
Phil, you sat through those sessions at the planning board. They thoroughly vetted this thing before they sent it up.
Yeah, it took me a while to get over the, I mean, they went through it. I came out of those meetings a little black and blue sometimes, but yes, they went through it thoroughly, yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Stuart, Nelson, are you satisfied to some degree? Stan, that some of your concern or questions have been at least, for the time being, have been answered? I think the key in all of this was, and I agree with the solicitor, there may have been incorrect or bad information put out there, and the whole attempt here tonight in having this discussion is to keep it transparent, to let the people know, because there was a four-page document before that used to encompass that whole historic district, and now this document is a lot longer. People all of a sudden says, oh my God, there's got to be something hidden in there that you know is going to bamboozle us somewhere in time, but that's certainly not the intent. The intent here tonight was to get the information out there, and you know, ultimately it'll be up to committee here whether they want to introduce this ordinance or not. And that's only the first phase of it, because once you have the next phase of it, there's also a public hearing on it. And the public always has an opportunity to come in and ask the questions, state their case, and ultimately that'll make the case for a lot of things whether they pass or not. So at that point, go ahead, Bob.
There have been a number of public hearings already. I've reviewed three or four sets of minutes from the planning board where it was publicly addressed in the open session at the end of each of those meetings by some of the folks that are actually sitting here and some of the folks that are on the current commission. It was also submitted to Pinelands. It was also submitted to the New Jersey State Historic, whatever they're called, another public agency.
It took a year with it.
So this thing has been wide open to the public for 9 years. It's here. Whatever date you set for the hearing, anybody that wants can testify for or against it. And that's the way that due process works.
Can Committee?
Mr. Mayor.
Go ahead, John.
I had a comment. Mr. Sandman and Mr. Sartorio pretty much covered everything that I was going to say. I just wanted to mention again the fact that the Historic Commission is simply a advisory board, and its decisions can be overturned or reversed by the planning board and the zoning official. And it's something I've had a lot of work on since 2008, and I certainly think it's come a long way. And with the reviews and the way it's been vetted at this point, I think it's time to move forward with it.
I understand. Rodney, I know you had some comments you wanted to make.
Yeah. I don't know, maybe some of you attended the last meeting. You know, I had concerns. I didn't have a chance to really review this document, and I wanted to have an opportunity to do that. I've certainly looked at it a lot harder since then. And fortunately, I've had a chance to talk with John Kurtz. We had a good discussion about this. And I talked with Phil. First of all, let me say that there's been a lot of hard work done by the committee and by others, and this is by residents who have done this, not because they're paid or anything, but because they have an appreciation for history, and they're doing it because they think it will help the township. So it's a very sincere effort. It's taken a lot of time and effort, and I appreciate it. I know that there are a number of areas that this addresses, one of which is the time it has taken in some cases to get approvals through. I've heard of stories where it's taken a couple of years and maybe even longer to get something through. There's an honest attempt here to address that, and that's good. As was mentioned, the document that we had did not pass state requirements, so we had to make modifications, and there questions, things that had to be added, they have been, and this does address that. It's mentioned that this has been 9 years in the making. That's certainly an indication of how tough it's been, and the hard work that many have put into it. I have gone through the document. I did have some comments, and you know, I don't like going through, I mean, there's some typos here which I don't want to bring out here, but there are some things, and I don't know whether this is the best time to bring these out or not. It's not extensive, but there are some items here, and I think the intent is to go forward with this the way it is, right?
Well, I think we would actually want to address them before we introduce, because we want to introduce something that we're all comfortable with presenting to the public, so.
Yeah. All right. Okay, well, there's some minor things, like in the first page here. People don't have copies of this, do they? Oh, that's unfortunate. On the first page here, there's a typo. It says building. It should be buildings. That's under B1. That's a minor point. On the page 3 of 18, just a question. We talk about the administration involved in this. We talk about the records that are necessary to be maintained, and just what came to my mind is the cost of this. I don't know how much this is costing, and I don't know how much of this has already been done, but there certainly are very definite record-keeping requirements. There was a question about the historic district, and it was mentioned that's already been documented. Now, is that true? The whole historic district has been documented? Because there are certain requirements here that must be met. The commission shall include, but are not limited to, data used to classification of buildings, structure sites, objects, improvements in districts, minutes, collateral data, decisions and appeals, and this goes on and on. You know, somebody has to pay for that. And it's already done.
Correct.
All right, very good. Another fact that was mentioned, there was a question about whether this could be expanded. I think it was answered. The historic district can be expanded. There are provisions for that, but that's probably unlikely. One thing I had some concerns with was the process by which the district can be expanded. And one of the, it says designation of an historic district shall not proceed over the written objection of 51% of the property owners. So it could proceed unless 51% of the property owners objected to it. That doesn't seem to make sense. I don't think it's a big problem because there are many other protections built in. But shouldn't it say 51% are in favor of it, or rather it requires 51% in favor instead of 51% have to be against it? All right, that's just something to think about.
Which letter was that?
I.
That was...
I.
That was I.
On 5 of 18.
What's it addressed at?
It says, under G, removal, a member of the commission may be after a public hearing if requested by removed. That's another typo. I don't know what it was trying to say. It says, this is item G. That's page 3 of 18. Item G says, removal, a member of the commission may, after a public hearing, if requested by, removed by the governing body for cause. So there's something missing there. It's a minor thing.
Which one was that, Rodney?
That was page 318, item G, removal is the title. Just looked like something was left out.
We're going back.
Under...
We
were on 5.
Under... Under H2, the Historic Preservation Commission shall hold hearings to review all applications for certificates of appropriateness, referrals of development, applications, and other business which comes before the commission. As I read through this, there seems like the process could be rather involved. I think there's one step that could be taken, to determine whether a certificate of appropriateness is needed. So, the property owner, whomever, has to go get a decision there if there's any question about it. Once that's done, they prepare the documentation in accordance with the requirements here. It's presented to the zoning board. Then the zoning board, in turn, considers it and presents it to the Historic Commission. The Historic Commission, in turn, makes their recommendations. They have up to 45 days to do that. And then it comes back. And it's potentially a lengthy process. So I was a little concerned about that, particularly when it comes to individual property owners who, haven't got time to study legal documents.
I can address that.
Okay.
If it is an application that does not require site plan approval or some action of the planning board, or if it is an application that does not affect density or use, which would require it to go to the zoning board, mm-hmm. then it starts with the HPC. Mm-hmm. And they can decide whether it's minor, which means it doesn't need a certificate of appropriateness, or it does. If they say it does, that goes to the planning board yep. to say yes or no. In the circumstances where it's an application for the planning board or the zoning board, they send it to the HPC for advice. Okay, and that's happening while the process in the zoning and planning board occurs. Excuse me.
So that is concurrent.
It's concurrent and doesn't cause a delay.
Hold on,
Judy.
I don't know if...
He's still... Let him finish it, and we can...
Okay. All right.
And then, of course, we have the requirements for the procedures for designation and what the requirements are. I mentioned the 51% under I.
Yep.
Page 518.
Ronnie, can we go back to that letter I?
Yeah.
So, Bob, do you think it's written that way, or maybe John, because there's an assumption of acceptance unless somebody objects, rather than seeking out the 51% acceptance?
I think that it is consistent with what I have seen in some of the other ordinances,
right.
Not all of them. But I think that if the HPC believes that a district is worthy of being designated that's not previously designated, that switches the burden of proof to the other side. And that's why it's 51%.
Right.
An example would be that in the trial of a case, scales of justice are in equipoise. The plaintiff has the burden of tipping it ever so slightly in its favor. Once that happens, has the burden of bringing it back, tipping it in its favor.
Mm-hmm.
And my guess is, and it's a pretty good guess, that that's where the 51% comes from.
Right.
I guess the question is whether we consider that to be our best, you know, our best choice.
That is for you all to decide.
Yeah, and that I think it'd be something we would want to decide before we introduce, because that would be a pretty significant change.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Under definitions, under emergency, this is 618. Okay. Definitions emergency. When an historic landmark or a key or contributing historic district resource requires immediate repair to preserve its continued habitability and or the health and safety of its occupants or others. Limited emergency repairs may be performed in accordance with applicable construction codes. My only point here is that this is a definition of an emergency. This has gone beyond the definition and adding what can be done, and I think we need to take a look at that and keep it at a definition. That's just something to think about. Under page 618, under in-kind, the definition of in-kind, it's toward the bottom third of the page.
Mm-hmm.
So it means replacing in-kind extensively deteriorated or missing parts of features when there are surviving prototypes. The new work should match the old in material design and texture and be unobtrusively dated to guide future research and treatment. Then it has not recommended dash replacing an entire architectural feature when limited replacement of deteriorate. I don't understand what this is trying to say. So might want, it's not clear to me.
It was 6 of 18, Ronnie.
This is page 6 of 18. It's in kind.
Not recommended.
And it may be just a matter of, you know, straightening the wording out, but it just
it's basically, I think the way that is, Rodney and John, again, you could probably speak better, but I think this is a scenario like what happened at Bank of America with the spindles.
Correct.
That's where basically this they had spindles that broke and they wanted to, they replaced them with square spindles instead of the actual historic.
Actually they had replaced them with cylinders, large cylinders.
Right. Rather than the kind of decorative one
that was there previously.
Right. Yeah. And so this basically says you have to have the same spindle.
Right.
For your replacements rather than a whole new thing that looks
correct.
Different.
That's the way I would interpret that. Yeah.
All right. As I read this again, maybe it's clear. maybe I read it too fast.
You're
under
right.
D, procedures on page 918. 9 of 18, D, procedures. It says, and this is talking about, if I'm not mistaken, the certificate of appropriateness.
Uh-huh. 203-2011.
It says that, except for the circumstances described in et cetera, above, no work shall be performed on any historic landmark or building, structure, site, object, or improvement located within a historic district until either a certificate of appropriateness has been issued for such work or until a determination has been made that no certificate of appropriateness is necessary for such work due to the fact that the proposed work constitutes ordinary maintenance and repair. I guess this, again, is a case where one could go before the Historical Commission and determine that the certificate was not required from them.
That is true.
Yeah, okay.
You not have to have that can be made by the chairman, and the definition of minor work is spelled out in the definitional sections.
All right. Under three, it says the talks about what's required for applications. It says sketches, drawings, photographs, descriptions of other information to show the proposed alterations, et cetera. Then it says the commission may require the subsequent submission of additional materials as it reasonably requires to make an informed decision. That's pretty open-ended. And I wonder if there shouldn't be maybe a time constraint or something associated with that. Again, that may be food for thought, but.
Did you say a time restriction?
Yeah.
I'm saying this statement says the it indicates the things that are required, and then it says the commission may require subsequent submission. So Can the commission spend, and I'm not saying this would happen, but spend, let's say, 60 days or, excuse me, 40 days, and then come back and say, well, you need to submit other stuff? And can that happen again?
If you look at five below that, they have 45 days from the submission to make a referral to the planning board.
All right, but does that mean that they can't come back within the 45 days and ask for additional material? If the right material wasn't submitted in the first place in their determination, couldn't they come back and get another 45 days when the full package was submitted?
I could see a circumstance where that happens, but I would say this to you. Under the current Municipal Land Use Act, the Planning Board has a specified period in which it must act after the application is deemed complete.
Yeah.
But the parties can always agree to extend that.
That's right. But here's my question. You said after the application is deemed complete. Perhaps what should be done is the SARA Commission should indicate whether it's complete at the time of submission, so you don't come back later on and say, well, we couldn't consider it because it wasn't complete.
We do that now. We have to first make sure that the application is complete before we'll even start discussing the application.
But it says here you can come back and ask for more information, which would suggest that it wasn't this complete.
And that's happened. We've had them come back and ask for, you mean us ask for more information?
Yes.
We can request an additional information because it doesn't provide the documentation that was needed at the time. And we've had people bring that back and drop it off with Rita at our secretary at the office, and that's sufficient. They don't have to come back before the commission.
All right, would the initial 45 days, would that be extended, or would that time frame still hold? It doesn't specify that here, and maybe it should to make it clear that it's not going to extend the application process.
So, John, what you're saying—
I would say this. Under your current ordinance, it is not specific as to what needs to be included in the application itself.
Well, there are a lot of things included here.
This specifies what must be included.
Exactly.
Right.
And it gives the applicant some relief that if they provide everything listed here, it shall be deemed complete. And I think that that's...
Shall be deemed complete, but they can come back and ask for additional documentation. I just want to somehow assure that that doesn't reset the clock. And there's nothing in here that indicates that.
Well, I think, John, correct me if I'm wrong, in that case, what it's meant to be for if you don't know what you don't know, right,
exactly.
At the time that you deem it complete. So you deem it complete, you're going through the review, and you might say, oh, for us to approve this, we just require this piece of paper from somewhere or something. Can you please drop that off in the office?
Absolutely.
And the approval is pending per the dropping off of that.
I get it, and I have no problem with it, but does a reset? It doesn't say anywhere here that it's going to still, an answer still be provided within the 45 days. Maybe there should be something in here specifying that. That's my only point.
Good.
How do you want to address it, Rodney? Do you have a recommendation on how to address it?
Yeah.
I think you have to look down at number five. It's very clear.
Yeah, I looked at number
five. They've got 45 days unless the applicant agrees to an extension.
That's the way I read it.
What page is that? Five.
That's right at the bottom.
Of 18.
That's under the assumption that a complete package was
Section,
submitted.
Again, the completeness, completeness is done at the zoning office where we make sure that, and it's a checklist form that they use and the information is provided.
Okay.
We sign off on it. It goes to the commission, and it's in their queue at that point.
It wouldn't hurt to indicate something in here that the time will not be extended.
Cool. Under the current ordinance, there is no time, correct?
No, there's nothing indicated as far as minimum time for decisions.
So right now, as we sit here, the HPC could take as much time as they want, right?
Pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is an improvement. That's one reason why it was written. We're just trying to make it as good as we can.
That to say submit its report to the zoning official within a maximum of 45 days?
I just wanted here to say the mission rate requires the subsequent submission of additional materials as it reasonably requires to make an informal decision. The requests for such additional information shall not delay the 45-day period, or something to that effect. You understand what I'm saying?
I
don't care what the wording is.
I completely understand what you're saying, and I will tell you this. If introduced tonight, that would not be a substantial alteration of this ordinance.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Phil and I can work on that.
Okay, very good. I notice it says on 5 that nothing herein shall prohibit an extension of time by mutual agreement of the applicant and the commission. So that's what it says, and I presume it means that the applicant would have to agree before time was extended. It says that, so I just want to make sure that's okay. Under 2A.
Page.
That's page 10, 18. A cultural resource survey shall accompany all applications for development in a Pinelands village and all applications for major development in order to determine whether any significant historical resources exist on that parcel. Well, I'm not sure what a Pinelands village is. I assume this is directed toward developers. And
it's a zoning designation, right?
That's correct.
I would defer to Phil on that.
We're not designated as Pinelands village.
Mr. Gouchard, that entire page, that's procedures in the Pinelands area. Yeah, that would apply to resources. Basically, we only have one Pinelands village, which is MISPA. And I think major development is at certain size subdivisions that could take place. But this section in its entirety is pretty much right out of the Pinelands Comprehensive Management Plan.
So it only applies to MISPA?
And they're not in the
Or anywhere where they're doing a subdivision over, again, I think the number is 10 units or 10 lots, if I'm not mistaken.
So should that even be in here, in this document, which deals with a historical district and requirements?
Yes, it's a requirement, yeah.
All right.
It is, yes.
Anyway,
it's required to become a CLG, but it's not applicable because we don't have Pinelands Village within our designated historic district.
That's correct.
But we have to have it there
to become there as part of our historic
the CLG. Right.
It's part of the Pinelands compliance process. Yes.
The necessary evil. Got it.
And doesn't it say that we have to, once we have the certificate of appropriateness, doesn't that have to go before the master plan and the Pinelands for approval? That's what it says here.
Which letter? Yeah.
I'm going back and forth, so.
10 or 18.
Yeah, those developments would be doing. These are steps they'd be taking at the Pinelands.
They'd be doing anyway.
Part of their application procedure. Yes.
It's part of the application procedure.
Mm-hmm. But it doesn't apply in Hamilton Township because we don't have any Pinelands Village right now in our current historic district designated. Correct?
Yeah, but this
applies to any type of development in the Pinelands.
Right.
It's under historic ordinance because they have a requirement that we address as part of our land use regulations, their cultural resource requirements. And this
right.
is a big part of it.
Yeah, but we do have a MISBA historical.
There are there's sites in MISPA
that are on the historic registry.
Are in the pocket sites in the district.
Okay.
Good. What else you got, Rod?
Yeah, and I tell you, I hate to bore all of you with this, but actually, there's no other mechanism where I can discuss this and with the whole committee. So, sorry about that.
I don't apologize. That's what we're doing.
On page 15 of 18, item 10, it says the maintenance of a sign within an historic district or affixed to or on the lot of a landmark or Pinelands designated site, whether existing prior to the effective date of this article or otherwise, shall require the issuance of a certificate of appropriateness under the standards of this article. My question is whether that's really needed.
I agree with you.
You agree with this?
I agree with you.
Oh.
You're reading clause 10?
Yeah.
I believe that if you have an existing sign on a structure that has been designated, that you're grandfathered in.
And it goes on to say that...
And by the way, not to interrupt you.
Hmm? No, sorry.
I would recommend removing that.
Okay. It goes on to say that the owners of signs in existence on the effective date of this article shall apply for and obtain a certificate of appropriateness for their respective signs within 5 years of the effective date of the site's designation, or their sign shall be removed. It doesn't indicate whether they ever get any warning about that before the signs are removed. So that's a minor point.
It'll be removed.
It'll be removed.
For that whole town.
We'll remove it.
Oh, okay.
You're recommending removing it before we introduce.
Grandfathering rights that are being violated by that, and it doesn't significantly alter the sign provisions of this ordinance.
That would fall under a minor thing then, and we can remove that?
Well, you're going to remove it if
we want to introduce it.
Right now, agree to remove it before you introduce it. It's out.
Yes, I do.
All right. That's really all the specific comments I had, but just a couple of general things to consider. We've talked about all the advantages of this. I want people to be clear that there are some costs associated with it. One cost is the question of who is actually footing the bill. The property owners in this area are the ones that get stuck with the bill. They're the ones that have to pay for the modifications. They're the ones that have to pay the additional costs. An example, I understand one of the properties in the district actually had to spend $60,000 above what it would have cost to make the renovations they needed in order to have renovations in compliance with the Historic Commission. I think we should just be aware of that, and I guess that's all my comments. Once again, I appreciate all the hard work that's been put into this, and I think it's been done with, you know, our better interests in mind, but there is a cost associated with it, and I think people should be aware of that.
But there's always been a cost associated with it.
That's right.
If you're buying a historic home, you should be prepared to treat it like a historic home.
Oh, that which reminds me, there's one thing I want to ask, and I hope I have the committee's agreement with that. With people that move in, I've heard of instances where people have moved in and they weren't aware of the requirements of the historic district ordinance. So I would like to request that the administration send out a letter to the local realtors asking them to be sure to make property owners aware, or potential owners moving into this district, aware of that it is a historic district and there are certain requirements associated with it. Mm-hmm. And I guess only fair.
That was addressed with a flyer previously, and we're in discussion right now of something to notify the realtors. But that was a flyer that we had done years ago. I remember that. And it was sent out to realtors so they could keep it on their counter and give it to people that are coming into the historic district.
Do they still have it?
Not all of them, I don't believe, no. But we're going to address that in another manner.
How about the person who has inherited a house in the historic district?
What kind?
Inherited a house in the historic district and really does not have any money to put into it.
When they come in, but that's where grant money would open up to do that.
Well,
when you come into you come into the zoning office for your permit, they advise you there that your property is located in a historic district, and you have to see them see the historic district in the HPC.
All right.
My question goes, and I deserve a little bit of time too. All this appropriateness. How does a person find out what colors are appropriate for their building, or what structures are appropriate? Maybe they've deteriorated and fallen down some of the structures on the house that they happen to be in.
We have a guide.
Yes,
and
it's available.
Guide.
It's available.
Is that available too? About when they sign up for this historic district, because I think that there should be more remuneration for people who go through this process, either through abatement through taxes or something of that nature, because this is an ordeal. No matter what you say, no matter how you say it's easy, it's not easy. You're taking time and money from a person who has bought this, and not really knowing what they're going to face. I don't know how many people who I've talked to have, said that it was really an ordeal to go through this, process. And so, in my way of thinking, You know, if we, the city government, is asking these people to partake in the historic nature, there has to be some sort of, in my opinion, humble opinion, that there has to be some way to compensate them for it. Because I went into the certificate of appropriateness, and I found the definition, and it says, often landowners find the COA confusing and don't understand what work requires what kind of documentation. This may lead them to receive heavy fines or to just not make any changes to their property for fear of being fined. So the other thing is that when they have now made all these significant changes, their values go up. 14% to 23% is what was in this document. It can be very expensive, and the high property value means high property taxes. I don't know how we adjust to this, or do we charge? What does Bill Johnson do as far as the assessment of these buildings once they have been made historic?
Bill.
Well, just to get to the one point you made about the impact and the added values, one of the things that we are working on this year, and you're part of the steering committee with the post-Sandy planning grant money, the second part of that, we're doing the Mays Landing neighborhood plan. The second part is the Mays Landing Historic District, looking at it for designation as an area in need of redevelopment or rehabilitation, which, if it's designated, would allow the committee to make the option of some form of five-year tax abatement available to people that improve their property and make significant improvements so that it offsets the cost you're talking about, Mrs. Link. So, we're working on that part of it, too.
Okay.
Is that it, June? Amy?
I'm baffled a little bit. The only question that I had, and I'm sure you guys made sure of this, but I just want to make sure it's on the record, because I noticed with this new ordinance, we're deleting and replacing a lot of sections of the original ordinance. I just want to make sure that we're leaving in the designation of our defined historic district. Because I didn't see in this document a replacement, so I'm assuming that piece is not getting touched.
We had to send a map of the historic district, including the pocket sites, up to Trenton. Before we could even begin the process.
Mm-hmm.
So they confirmed that our designation was the way it was, and our district was defined the way it is, including our pocket sites. And we have a copy of that map available at the clerk's office for anybody that wanted to see that.
So where is that memorialized?
That is memorialized. It's indicated in another section of the development ordinance with the zoning maps. I think it's technically zoning map 5, historic areas map.
Okay.
And the boundaries of the historic district were last reviewed by the governing body and itemized basically by block and lot number as part of that ordinance in, I believe, 1995, Bob?
I can make it absolutely clear.
You can make it clear. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob.
Yeah. And here's how I can do that. If this is introduced tonight, it is not intended and shall not affect ordinance number 1, 2, 3. Can't tell if that's an 8 or a 0, -96. That's the ordinance which lists all of the properties located within the district.
Okay.
And all of those pocket sites located outside of the district, but which have been designated.
Okay, so that's great. That answers my question. Other than that, I would say I think the couple of changes that Mr. Gouchard proposed aren't unreasonable and help, make this a more solid ordinance. And you know, I mean, Judy, with respect to some of the points you made, I think you're actually kind of raising a question of, do we want to continue to have historic preservation or not? And to me, that answer is absolutely yes. That's part of who we are. That's part of our charm as a town, and it's extremely important to me and in our Main Street area that we have standards so that we maintain that essence of our history. I don't think it's unreasonable that if you're buying a historic house in a historic district and you want to make changes, you got to pay for it. It's just like if you know, you want to make changes to your own home, and you know, we have the municipal land use law and the construction code. The construction code says I have to put in a certain type of outlet. I'm not going to require the government to pay for that outlet. That's what I have to do to make that improvement. So I don't find it unreasonable. I think knowledge is power, so the education piece is important to people who are buying or selling in the historic district. And maybe that's somewhere where we can improve. But to me, there's no question as to whether or not we should continue to want to urge historic preservation. And I think everybody who's worked on this has done an outstanding job on taking what we had, expanding it, making it more clear, more clearly defined, you know, documenting out processes in a much better way to continue that history that we enjoy.
Okay, Amy, I did not say that I was not in favor of preserving history. If you could look at our home, you know.
I know, that's why I was kind of shocked to hear some of your comments,
but,
actually.
But, you know, you have to, you know, make it palatable. And, you know, and not that you're going to give away the store, but in this climate, you know, we do have a lot of people who really don't have any money and are making a difficult effort to pay their taxes. And, you know, so if there's a little bit of help there, that would be good if they can get a grant, which I would hope that they would be forthcoming, because history needs to be subsidized. It many people do not feel the same way you do, especially when they spent $60,000 more in building their dwelling or commercial establishment. Yeah, they you know it. So then when they go to sell something that's in the historic district and it has all these small rooms, has no ability to expand, they have to have the ability to be modern inside. And, you know, if we can somehow, you know, make this process a little bit more economical, I think we should.
Your comments are well taken. Please, Stan. I know you're concerned, so.
Thank you.
Maybe Stan can give some light on his experience.
She and I are business people. We think differently than other people, and she brings out a good point. And I just want the group to consider. You can be for historic preservation. Viability becomes huge, and things need to be weighed up. Amy mentioned Main Street. Fine, we have a lot of historic homes there. However, what do you do when it becomes apparent that a little commercial property with a storefront is only worth the rentable value of that storefront? So if the storefront can get $500 a month for a beauty parlor, and as time goes on, someone wants to buy that building, and they're gonna have to put hundreds of thousands of dollars in to keep that thing within the way that the Historic Commission sees fit for that building, and they can still only get $500 a month for that building, they're gonna walk away from it, and the area will become blighted. And that's another problem that you have to consider. And you can't, you know, even the Verizon building, I agree, it doesn't belong there, it's an albatross. However, as a taxpayer from a township standpoint, how much do they pay in taxes for that building versus a dilapidated single-family home that may have still been on that site? So what's better for the township?
As a resident, I don't really care.
I care. I care. It's about dollars and cents. And if you, and if you don't care, you're going to have a cute downtown that you may as well build a facade like in Blazing Saddles with a bunch, with just a piece of plywood going across that's painted real nice, because behind it will be a bunch of things that have fallen apart and no one will buy, because there's no financial reward for repairing them or keeping them up. And somewhere in there, and I'm not saying, you know, no more history, but you have a responsibility to do what's right all the way around. And like Judy says, there has to be something, because there becomes a point where things aren't fixable. They're always fixable for a price, but they're not fixable from a business standpoint. And that's with homes, that's with storefronts, that's with a lot of things. And that has to be part of the spirit of this document, because you can't have an area designated historic forever, no matter what. And I think there should be the ability to raise a building and replace it with something that is appropriate for the district that might be more useful.
I can comment on that a little bit, Stan. We just had a property in town, if you're familiar with it, Pack Rats, and they had damage from the storm that produced over 50% of the property was damaged. And we granted demolition to that outfit so that they could rebuild. And we had a process where we could discuss how they could rebuild and still keep the historic character and flavor to the building under the new construction. So there are mechanisms in this paperwork to make that happen.
Thank you. We, look, normally a lot of this is preserved for public, but I think this issue is so important that I'm going to allow it tonight. Nelson.
So you're allowing public comment on this item right now?
Yeah, I'm allowing it.
Thank you.
It's all part of being transparent and getting everything on board and on the table. So that.
Well, not the sharpest marble, so I've got a couple questions. Pocket site, what is that?
Pocket sites? The ordinance was created back in, if I may.
Please.
Sure. 1996 has two separate descriptions. The first one is the historic district, which is a boundary within the downtown Mays Landing. And then pocket sites are those who are historic but not within the district.
Okay, are they designated in, there's a document that shows where?
Yeah, correct. By lot and block.
And going back to the 51%, I'm not sure how that worked out. Does that mean if the, maybe you guys can answer this, if the commission wants to expand the district, say six blocks, you know, A, B, C, D, does 51% of the homeowners have to approve that, or what is the 51%, Bob or whoever?
Yeah.
I think it's a land.
50 have not approve it. They have to be against it in order to prevent it from moving forward. So 51% have to be against it. And those are the people affected, the property owners affected by it.
That's correct.
Yes.
Thank you. Go ahead, Cheryl. I'll get you next.
Absolutely.
That's not our business, Judy. We don't go inside a house. Our only concern is the exterior. And our only concern is they keep it as much as possible original.
Yeah, I understand.
Now, we don't go and go to people's house and say, you got to fix that column. When they're ready to do it, they come to us. We don't go out there telling people what to do. It's up to them. We don't tell them how much to spend. I don't know of anybody that has ever come to us and that we cost them $60,000. I really want to know who that is, because I can't believe it. There is no way. So, I mean, you said it, and I want to know who, because I'm really upset about that more than anything else. That's just so horrendous. And there's so much rumors that goes around, and people, when they do come to us, they're like, God, because we're treated like orphans. It just, it annoys me so much when I hear this stuff. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I understand this is a very hot, debated, contested issue for the township, and I appreciate both sides. But as a homeowner who's just, I don't have the bill, I've never seen the bill or the ordinance, is there a flowchart? How do we go from applying to, I'm buying a home, I want to change this, it's in the historic society, is there a flowchart to help me get from point A to point B to point C? Because I've heard from everyone, you go from point A to C to D, and it's so simple, well, I wrote it down, it's not that simple. So is there a flowchart that can be a part of that ordinance? Is there something that says that to the average homeowner, not to the attorney, not to the solicitor, not to the ones that have been on the board, but to the average homeowner, you know, something that is understandable, identifiable, readable?
Go ahead, Phil.
Yes, there is. It's as part of the book of guidelines and templates, so to speak, that the commission has established.
Is it in this ordinance?
It's not in the ordinance. It's part of the application document itself.
Okay. So that this ordinance is what's being approved or what's going to be approved. How can the public comment on it if it's not in the ordinance?
It is in the ordinance.
A flowchart.
No flowchart. If you're asking us, how do you get designated?
I'm asking you to get me from, I bought a home, I found out it's designated as historic.
Okay, that's a different question. Then your question is, how do I get a certificate of appropriateness if I want to do work?
Okay. So now we've gone from point A to point B or point A to D.
No.
Is there a flowchart? And I think that's important for the public.
Under the current ordinance, you would have more questions on how to get from point A to point Z than you would under this ordinance. This ordinance tells you if you want a certificate of appropriateness, here's what you do. And you turn to the pages of the ordinance which address the certificate of appropriateness, and it tells you step by step what to do and where to go and how to do it, when it's required and when it's not.
Okay. Is there a way, or on the website, for something that is not legal, something that is easy for an average person to just follow?
Can that be developed? I mean, that's the question. What's the difficulty in developing a flowchart?
There is. Again, I go back. As part of the
the
application that a person files for a certificate of appropriateness, there is a decision flowchart showing you make your application, is it complete or not?
Very good. The question is, does that apply to this new ordinance? Does the same flowchart apply to this
yes.
new ordinance?
Yes.
All right, there's the answer.
No, a flowchart just shows the steps in the process, not the documentation you need to provide at each step.
A good flowchart would have, as the homeowner, I need this documentation, as this. I'm saying to become more user-friendly, more, to be able to appease the public.
The application itself is very clear as far as information that should be provided. If you're doing a, changing your windows, it's a checkbox, I'm changing windows. Here's the information. It's in the application procedures.
Okay, now, my next question is, you were talking about realty. If I were to be buying a home, would this ordinance be part of my deed? Is it deed restricted? Is it something that I should have in my deed?
No, it isn't. It isn't currently a deed restriction.
No, it's an ordinance, not a deed.
But there are not restrictions.
There are historic townships that there are deed restrictions to what you can do, but we don't have that here.
Okay. My next question is signage. You were saying that there are signs that are designated. Are they the same signs? Are they aesthetically correct? If I'm going to be living in a township that has historic value, shouldn't all the signs be pretty much the same?
No, there's a sign, there's a pamphlet that designates proper signage, as well as if you're replacing a fence, we have a fence brochure so that the person is easily guided through the type of fencing that's appropriate.
I understand that, but I didn't know if there was something for signage.
Yes.
It's a learning process.
Yes.
You're right. You're absolutely right. I think all the questions that get asked are good questions, because if you don't know the answer, you should have the ability to find it and someone that you can be directed to that would lead you to the path of satisfaction, okay? So I thank you for your comments.
I have to say, Lise, I don't think you're, I can picture what you're envisioning as an operations person myself. So I have to say, I don't think it's a bad suggestion, not only as it relates to this, but as it relates to planning, zoning, construction, because I've had that, my own frustration with that. The only thing I can tell you is right now, we have really great people in the offices who will guide you through the process. Is it something you could guide through easily independently? Probably not very easily. You can read stuff and navigate, but we probably have opportunity there. The problem is manpower and priority and
right.
stuff like that. So if a volunteer such as yourself wanted to tackle that.
I see you're smiling already. Good.
I was going to encourage getting a hold of that guideline, the flowchart that he talked about, taking a look at it.
She will.
Yeah, give us some feedback.
Yes, she will. No one leaves. Right. She will. Thanks, Lee.
Listen, I know we've had a long period of discussion tonight. Normally, we get into that during the public portion, but I thought it was important enough tonight to put it all on the table before any action is taken on this proposed ordinance. And I thank all of you, and I like the fact that a lot of it is spirited, and hopefully in some way you've had the majority of your questions answered. I think, as the solicitor said earlier, it's a living document. And over time, you find things do change, but obviously it's not going to change immediately. And I think a lot of what has to happen is, let's see where we go with this with committee now.
Well, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to just kind of summarize what I think we changed
sure.
and then possibly put that on the table for an introduction. So I think we changed page 3 of 18, letter G on the middle of the page, removal. I think we just need that definition, the syntax, just to be improved a little bit there.
Right.
I think page 5 of 18 is the 51% thing on letter I. I'm comfortable introducing as it is, but if not, we need to make a decision on that.
That would be a material alteration.
Right. 6 of 18, the emergency definition. I think, Rodney, what you were intending is potentially to cut the quote-unquote definition off at health and safety of its occupants or others, period.
That's right. It goes beyond
right.
just the definition.
So cut right. it off at others, period, and get rid of the kind of process stuff that's there. The in-kind piece.
I understand that now. It's the way it was worded. That's actually what it's saying. It's not recommended, and then it should be a colon, I guess, replacing an entire architectural feature, et cetera. I believe that's what it's trying to say. That's not recommended.
So change the dash to a colon. Yep. All right. Minor. And then I think on page 9
18.
Of 18, number 3 at the bottom, we're going to change the commission may require the subsequent submission of additional materials, and it shall not extend the period as set forth in section 5 below. Bob, yeah. you're going to add wording there?
That would do it. No.
Phil or Bob is going to do it.
And then 15 of 18, right?
And then, hold on, I made notes.
Right.
And 15 of 18, number 10, we're going to remove. And I believe that's it.
A couple other minor things.
The spelling
with a
corrections.
A couple typos and things yeah. like that that we can get taken care of.
Yeah. Page 10 of 18, under 2, little a, 3, that should read E2B instead of E5B.
Okay.
And on the following page, 11 of 18, under section D, that should read E3D2.
Okay, sure.
And Phil and I will work together to put this in a final form, but.
Okay, if that's what's on the table, John, I don't know if you want
to. Sure, I'll move to introduce ordinance 17, number 1785-2015, amending Section 203 of the Code of the Township of the Hamilton regarding the establishment of the Historic Preservation Commission.
I'll second.
All right, discussion, please.
Please, go ahead.
Also, incumbent in that, I would suggest that you include that the designation of the Historic District, as well as the pocket sites as set forth in Ordinance 1230, either 38 or 30-96, adopted on 5/13/96, that the deletion of any existing ordinance does not affect the delineation of the historic sites contained within the ordinance adopted on 5/13/96.
So you want that in an amended motion?
I do.
Okay. Could you say that again? Just kidding.
Whatever he said, you're amending, correct?
That's it.
Okay,
and Rodney's seconding?
And you're seconding?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any other questions or comments?
Going back to that historic district and landmarks, I was under the impression that anything 50 years or older is subject to be calling a landmark.
I don't know.
That was what Phil Sartorio told me.
Well, I qualify.
What?
I qualify.
You qualify?
We already knew that.
Okay. Well, just putting it out there, because a lot of this is designated to landmark, you know, and the 51% and so on and so forth.
What I'm saying, Judy, is that there's a document which lists each of the affected sites and the district.
Exactly.
With the amendment that's just been placed on the floor, that is not going to change.
And well, there still could be an amendment to this document.
Yes.
You know, where it has something that is 50 years or more.
Right. And if the ordinance that we're talking about now is ultimately adopted, it sets forth the procedure how you add to that.
Precisely.
And it defines here, historic landmark shall mean any building, structure, site, object improvement, which qualifies for designation under Section 4 of the ordinance. So I'm following the designation process. That's what it says for historic landmark.
Okay, any other questions or comments?
Yeah, my question is somebody going to have this all rewritten and to me before 10 o'clock tomorrow so it can get in the paper in time to have a public hearing on the 16th, or you're going to have the public hearing the first meeting in April?
Whatever matter works for you. If you can't, then you make it to when you can. Okay?
You what?
I don't want you getting ulcers over it.
Yeah, I think.
Okay, can we have a roll call, Mrs. Anderson?
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gouchard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
Well, yes, and carried.
Thank you, and thank everybody for your comments. I appreciate it. I'm sure the rest of the committee does.
What was the public hearing date now?
I think we should announce the date of the public.
Do you want to announce the date you want to make it?
Give yourself some time. I can't do it by 10 o'clock.
Let's make it May 2nd then. Was
no,
May 2nd?
April.
April 2nd.
April.
Okay.
I lost it already. That's what happens when you're
historic. So public hearing,
landmark.
April 2nd.
Okay.
Okay? Good.
Very good. Thank you.
And thanks for you bringing that up, Mrs. Anderson.
Or the first meeting in April is
Mrs.
what
Mrs. Anderson,
right?
Smile now. Thank you. All right. Next item on the agenda is the tax abatement pilot program for the industrial park as recommended by the Township Industrial Commission. Can we get the members of the commission that wanted to come up here tonight and speak about this? Did you want to do it, Gordy, or did you want to take it?
Or Charlie?
Charlie. You're writing for the paper, right? Okay. Please, Gordy.
Basically, with the help of Bill Johnson, and Bob Sandman, we put together these sort of recommendations of what we feel would be the best for the town. So what we're basically presenting is the pilot plan should include all lands in the IPP zone, which is more than the industrial park. But Bob, do you have a map that shows that?
I don't have it here.
You had it at the meeting that night because it had the...
Yes, it's like Schulten's, Wheaton's, and self-storage. So just areas that would be helpful. Instead of redesigning a new area, this is a zoning area. The IBP zone has already been established, and so we're not going to reinvent the wheel. The final plan should be a 5-year abatement pilot plan, which provides zero tax abatement on new improvements, additions, and renovations for year one, 20% the value of the improvements year two, 40% the value in year three, 60% year four, 80%, and year five thereafter would be 100%. The pilot program would only apply to new improvements, additions, or majors and renovations. The pilot plan recognizes the abatement would start January 1 of the succeeding year. They complete the project in March, and they're going to pay the full taxes until that next January. The main component of the real estate taxes will remain assessed land separate and distinct from the improved value. So a land portion will be treated as it is currently. I don't know if you have any questions of me.
Mr. Solicitor?
Yeah, because of the state law, I am the solicitor to the Industrial Commission as a matter of law, because I am the solicitor to the township. The Industrial Commission created a subcommittee to evaluate and study this. The subcommittee met with relevant folks. Testimony was taken by Tony DiDio, who was here tonight, who is our marketing agent for the Industrial Commission. And it was the considered opinion of the members of the Industrial Commission that we can't really compete in today's market with places that give these kinds of abatements. We have approvals on the book now. For example, we have the Harrison Beverage Project that we sold some time ago, and they have not constructed yet. It is the considered opinion of the folks on the Industrial Commission that this might entice them to do that. And that would, A, create jobs, B, create construction of a major facility. And under the agreement that the township made with Harrison Beverage, they're obligated to improve two new streets and do the drainage and other work associated with that, which would open up, I think, four additional lots of development. Mm-hmm. So in just that one individual circumstance, it was the collective feeling of the Industrial Commission that that would be a good thing. The other thing is that you're always going to collect the full tax on the land value. And the second year, you're going to get 20% of the improvement value. And that goes up 20% each year. Until 5 years out, you're going to get 100%. And the feeling of the commission, it's better to get 20% of something next year than nothing.
And also, it doesn't go into the general fund. It gets designated as a special project fund, so you can use the money for whatever you deem necessary.
One-time revenue for one-time expense, right.
Yes.
And I think that Tony DiDio's testimony was most compelling because he's in that industry. He deals with large industrial properties, commercial properties, throughout southern New Jersey. He's a member of a national or international company, and he's having a hard time getting folks to come on into the park and build. So what it's felt to do is to make the lands that are currently undeveloped available for the process to entice buyers, and to have folks that have approved sites. We're aware of another site that has full approvals, attractive to somebody to come in, where we can compete with Vineland and Pleasantville and places like that.
I also received phone calls from an owner-operator out of Egg Harbor Township who read in the paper that we were considering this, and they said that would be the straw that would entice them to come to the park.
That is good.
Awesome. That's good to hear.
Just calls out of the blue, they're calling us up and saying, wow, we think this is a great idea, please follow through on it.
Well, we have known for a long time that our industrial park is just sitting there. I mean, the whole infrastructure has been in place. It's a relatively active park now, but it could stand a lot more business. And when we look at the economy today and we talk about, you know, what would that do to the area? First of all, it would create jobs. We'd bring people into the area who will spend money on businesses. And the normal traffic that we have through the township obviously would increase, but in a positive way. So, you know, I happened to be present that night that they passed this resolution, and having sat on that commission for a few years, the industrial park has been close to me. I mean, I live near it, you know, I'm in there frequently walking, and it's got a lot to offer. And I think to be competitive, it puts us in a great position today. And I think the fact that a lot of our neighboring communities, the larger townships, Egg Harbor has an industrial park, but it's not nearly as attractive as ours. And you've been through it, Gordy, so you know what I'm talking about.
But they have abatement.
Huh?
But they have abatement.
Yes, they do. And I think that was, this should be the catalyst. So looking at it from that, it makes sense to consider this. Rodney?
Yeah, I just wanted to, at the last time this came up, I asked if you all had done some investigation and looked at what's happening in surrounding communities to assure that what we're doing is competitive, et cetera, et cetera. I assume that's been done.
Absolutely.
It probably goes without saying, so that's fine. But I do have a question. You mentioned that it doesn't affect the land value, and just out of curiosity, and I realize that would vary depending on the structure, but what percentage typically of the tax is land versus the improvement? And it varies, I understand, but... Well,
a hard question
20,
to answer.
30%?
It's a very hard question to
answer. Very hard question to answer.
The land values in the park, the sale prices have typically been less than market value for the purposes of enticing purchasers. There's no formula that says it's a percentage of it. It is what our assessor says it is.
And one thing I'd like to add, Mr. Guichard, is out of the approximate 600 acres or so in the business park, 58% of that is still undeveloped after 30-some years. And a majority of that, probably 54% of it, is still owned by the township. So right now, we're not getting a penny out of it.
So it sounds like the land value is not that high.
If this encourages a sale,
all right.
You know, it'll generate revenues that way through taxes. So.
Yeah. I guess that answers your question.
Well, you know, our principal source of revenue in a township is real estate taxes. That's it. And if we can't in the economy generate some sort of an interest in it, then I think we're missing a great opportunity. So, Judy, you had a comment? Are you all right?
No, I feel as though it is an excellent idea. And, you know, we have to stay competitive in this environment, and I think it would be a great way to do it. I mean, this is all of our land to begin with, and so anything that we can get is going to be a plus.
Yep, absolutely.
Mr.
Tonight, I just think that what you need to do, in my opinion, is to author, if you are of a mind to go forward with this, right now we're in the conceptual phase.
Mm-hmm.
Would be to authorize myself and Phil and others to do what's necessary procedurally to bring this back to you, get this accomplished.
So the resolution that we have doesn't do that? If we were to...
I haven't seen it.
That's my question.
I think that's the industrial park resolution.
It is. It is. So you would need
Resolution 1-2015?
Yeah, it came. Yeah.
Yeah.
Go to the bottom page.
I know. That's what I'm saying. Can't we just approve that?
All you have to do is, by a majority vote, authorize me and Phil to proceed.
Any other members have any comments?
Well, I just wanted to mention that the mayor and I sat in on the industrial commission meeting, the last one, and they've done a great job working on this, and it's something that's going to be needed to move the township forward, as you mentioned, by people showing interest in the pilot program, and we need to get things moving out there. So great job. Thank you.
Thank you.
I make a motion that we enable our solicitor and others to proceed.
I'll second.
Motion is second. Any other questions or comments?
Yeah, I'd just like to once again thank the group for the great job that was done. And for looking in and doing the research that has brought you to where you are now.
Thank you.
Can we have a voice roll call, please, Mrs. Anderson?
Okay. Ms. Gatto?
Yes, and thanks to Mr. DiDio for also
Mr.
helping
Gishard.
With all of our...
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silver?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Thank you, everyone. Appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.
Okay, the next item is the Cove and Cove fees. This item is on the agenda because of a flurry of Oprahs that actually one major Oprah that came into the township from someone that lives where, North Carolina. And what they're doing is that individual and whatever local cohorts with that individual trying to look at all the applications for beach badges in the township for last year. And he reviewed, I think, 100 of them so far, and he found out that some of the people misrepresented their application.
Their address.
Their address, correct. Well, but in reality, is it because a lot of people have a zip code that is Mays Landing? Some people have a zip code that's Pleasantville, 08234, when they live over by the McKee section. Some people who live in Weymouth do have a Mays Landing. And the amount of time that it's requiring our administrative staff and even legal and others to produce all these documents is going to be horrendous.
They've already spent 16 hours on the first 1,000 pages.
Yeah, and
which
from
is
what,
year one.
And from what I understand, it's going to be more. So I believe we decided to put this on the agenda to consider eliminating the application and come up with a standard fee for the Cove for a day badge and for a season. And I think moving forward, it probably makes the most sense to do that.
And other beaches do that also, right?
They do, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, beaches, sure. You got your day badge or your season. And I think it makes the most sense. Where this is going to go after that, it only knows, Mrs. Solicitor, you've been involved. You know, it's time consuming. I know we're keeping track of it. And it may far exceed whatever misrepresentation that people either willingly or unwillingly made in filling out the application. So I think in trying to move it forward, I think it's in our best interest just to establish a day fee. Michael, comments about a fee.
We took a look at the numbers, and the break even, in other words, on the last 4 years average, would be somewhere between $13 and $14 for the seasonal, and somewhere between $8 and $9 for a daily.
And that would be, in other words, what would happen is regardless of where the person lived, they would pay $14 for a seasonal badge, or if they came for the day, it would be $9, correct?
Yes.
Without any application, they would just get the badge.
Buy the badge.
Buy the badge like they do in many other communities.
And how much more is that than the current, than the fee last year?
The current?
No?
Current fee is $6 for a resident. For daily, $9 for non-resident daily. So it'd be essentially the same for a non-resident. A resident pay a little bit more, but the seasonal one is currently 12. It would only go to 14, so it's only a $2 difference, and it's 24 for a non-resident. So it's significantly cheaper. Most of the seasonal badges are sold to residents. 90% of them actually.
And you feel what percentage of the people who use the Cove live in the township? You think most of half are outsiders?
I'd say more than half live in town. But
yeah.
Okay.
If I can, Mr. Mayor, just to kind of give a little bit of background here.
Sure.
Jenny, maybe you can help me with the year, but it was several years ago, I'd say 5-6 years ago, when we were considering either closing the Cove and or eliminating swimming at the Cove during our really major fiscal crisis. Mm-hmm. You know, we had several residents that spoke up with regard to trying to save the Cove. And at the time, we were cutting pretty much any, you know, thing that was considered a non-essential or non-public health, safety, wellness related expense. And because of the outcry from the residents, even at that time, We did develop a subcommittee that I sat on with, at the then time, Deputy Mayor Kane, Jenny Ayers, and former Committeewoman Dix, and put a lot of work into looking at the concerns that we had from the fiscal side of the house in the township, but also the, you know, the needs that we wanted to meet from the residents' perspective. And that's how we actually came to have the resident, non-resident fee, because we were trying to keep things as affordable as possible for our people, but still get the revenue needed to keep the cove operational and breaking even. So that's how we actually established the differentiating fee. So I think, you know, that we're in a better place now, and it makes sense that we just go to a single fee. It's less work for our people. It's less work for those that are at the beach. And I think we'll still be able to hit the break-even point and not put the cove at risk. So that's it.
Anyone else on committee?
Would we still be?
I was just thinking that, you know, not a full application might be, you know, something that you could do, but you could possibly get people's email and, you know, send out a blast if we're doing something unusual, you know, like games or whatever, you know, just to make it a little more exciting, you know, and well, hopefully build up the thing. But it's not necessary. It's just, you know, just a thought.
So that would be optional for the people to fill in or not.
Sure, whether yeah, they want to provide that.
Right, yeah. Right.
Well, they could always sign up on our township email, and if we ever do have anything exciting going on at the Cove, which I can't remember what time the last time we put on an activity at the Cove,
yeah,
we could email it out then. Well, if they sign up for the township email.
Do you think there would be a problem getting an email?
Some people don't want to give them.
Well, if they don't, that's fine. It would be optional.
You could always get it when they came to the Cove. If you're interested in any future events we may have, just put your email
could,
on a list.
Raffle off a dinner with.
Don't start. Anyone?
Okay.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask if would we still continue to sell tickets at another location outside of the town hall?
Why not?
I don't see why not.
Be less cumbersome at this point, right?
Meaning the Merchants Association members assist,
yes,
with selling the badges so that we can try to maximize the number of badges sold.
Sure.
Correct.
Right. I don't see any reason with.
Sure.
What's your pleasure?
I make a motion to change our Cove fees.
Yeah.
Oh.
I got to put it in ordinance form.
I make a motion that we do the ordinance to change the Cove fees to a single fee at $9 for daily and $14 for seasonal.
I'll second
that. Motion is second. Any questions or comments? Mrs. Anderson, roll call, please.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gushar?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes. And thank you, everyone. Okay. Consent agenda. I would like to pull out N and O.
N and O?
Yep.
Make a motion.
I would like to pull out, excuse me, the B.
B.
Okay.
Make a motion to approve 6A with the additions C through M, period.
Have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
No, I have a motion.
Okay. Second?
A motion is second. Any questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. B, Roddy?
Yeah, I just wanted to, this issue of the Transportation Trust, I just want to, again, make people aware of the fact that the money in the Transportation Trust is running out, and the need for renovation of our infrastructure here in New Jersey with the bridges and the roads, et cetera, is very, very, is very high. The problem, of course, is how to fund it. To me, as detestable as it may be to many, it seems like the most direct way would be through a gasoline tax. The gasoline prices now are low. There's an absolute need for this, and I don't know where else the money would come from. So I would just like to encourage that people support this, and that we try to get that moving. That's all I have.
Okay, so
So I'd like to propose accepting this.
So you want to...
I will move to accept B.
We have a second.
I didn't realize that this included a gasoline tax.
No, I
what?
Didn't either.
I didn't either.
It included a what?
Gasoline.
I didn't realize that this includes it.
No, no, I'm not saying it does. What I'm saying
how
is...
How I feel about taxes.
Yeah, well, all I'm saying is I recommend supporting this...
resolution.
This resolution, that's right. Just saying, in my own personal view, we need to get funding.
Oh,
it's desperately
okay.
needed.
Well, I'll tell him to send you to taxes, keep them away from me.
I support the Transportation Trust, not do a gas tax.
Okay, so...
Transportation Trust has no money.
We know that.
Okay.
Well, we didn't deplete it. They wasted it. B?
You have a motion and a second.
Okay. Questions or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. N, the resolution approving 2014 MREM foreclosure list. Michael?
Yes, sir, Mayor. I'd suggest we pull 40. It's a church. It's a block building. Not sure we want to take ownership of it.
Everything else on the list is simply land. There's
yes.
no buildings, right?
That's correct.
So therefore, no liability.
Correct.
This would be a liability if we took it.
It possibly could be, yes.
Yeah, I support that.
Okay, so on N?
Make a motion to approve the resolution for the 2014 in-rem foreclosures, deleting 40.
Second.
Do I have a motion and a second? Any other questions? Yeah, I will.
Sure.
Any other questions or comments? Can we have a roll call, Mrs. Anderson?
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gashard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
The reason I pulled out O is just to highlight the fact that this letter has come from the GIF, from the executive director, and said it's our pleasure to report that the Hamilton Township has earned $1,500 as a result of your outstanding performance in a 2014 ACMJIF Safety Incentive Program. Due to your employees' efforts, Hamilton Township has qualified for reimbursement of $1,500 to be used for recognition of your employees' safety accomplishments. We would also like to extend our congratulations to your fund commissioner, Ingrid Perez, your safety coordinator, Lisa Marcolongo, your claims coordinator, Mary Kelly, and all your employees who played an important role in achieving these results. And the reason I pulled it was just to call your attention to it. I think they do an outstanding job, and I think we'd be remiss if we didn't acknowledge that by recognizing them. So what's your pleasure on O?
First of all, I think we should give those guys all a round of applause.
I
so
do
great
too.
Job.
Yeah.
And then I think we should move to accept the $1,500 award. So I make that motion.
I'll second it immediately.
All right.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Great. Thank you, everyone. Okay. The next item on the agenda, there's no seven. Eight approvals. February 17, 2015, regular meeting minutes.
I'll make a motion to approve them.
I'll second.
A motion is second. Any questions or comments? All those in favor? Okay. Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries.
I abstain.
Abstain. Great. June 16, 2014, regular meeting minutes.
So moved.
Second. I have a second. Questions or comments? Can we have a roll call on that, Mrs. Anderson?
Yes. Who seconded it?
Judy.
Judy.
Yes.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gashard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Abstain.
Abstained. Mrs. Link?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes. Thank you. C, payroll and bills totaling $3,849,683.01.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Roll call.
I have a problem with the penny.
Yeah, well, it's still part of the current, it's still part of our system. O-1, yeah. Roll call, Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishar?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Thank you. Item 9, reports. Mr. Administrator.
Mayor, I have nothing to add to my written report.
Mr. Solicitor.
Nothing to report.
Bob, you've been quiet.
Nothing to add to my written report,
Thank
Mayor.
You. Township Committee. Judy?
I think I'm going to pass.
Okay, no problem. John?
I just wanted to say that a discussion tonight was long and heated, but I think it was needed for the ordinance. And we heard a lot of comments from people. Rodney had some suggestions that we are going to work in. And I think it helped move this ordinance forward. Thank you.
Good. Thank you. Rod?
I didn't think it was that heated.
I didn't think it was heated. I thought it was interactive.
I thought it was a good discussion. It's the kind
interactive.
The kind we should have on things like this that affect segments of our population. I had a few items. One, I attended the, and so did Judy, the League of Municipalities meeting. Atlanta County Association of Township Administrators meeting, and on Roger's behalf, the mayor's meeting. And I won't go into details on all of these, but let's just let me say that we all have common problems, and we discussed them. I thought it interesting that in the tax area, anyway, the numbers I heard weren't that outlandish. I think the highest number I heard, and that was in Ventnor, and that was because of a $61 million loss in assessed valuations. They were talking about around 4.5 cents, even though they have a reduced budget. But that's the way these land valuations are affecting people. The next highest was 4.5, and the rest were below that. So it's been painful for most of the townships, but it's been happening and it's moving along. I happened to attend, and I just want to mention, a meeting in Atlantic City, and the meeting was on the relationship between the community and the police force. They had an excellent representation of people there. They had the Chief of Police of Atlantic City, Chief of Police of Pleasantville. They had several community leaders. They had teachers. And they had two mothers of sons who were killed by the police. In one case, a lady's son was shot twice in the back. In the presence of witnesses, and she gave a very emotional testimony. And there was a very frank discussion. It went on for, a couple of hours. It was not one-sided. It was a fair discussion of the problem, and it is a serious problem, and it's certainly just not related to certain areas of the country. One of the gentlemen that was there happens to be a pastor and a former policeman, and he was selected to be part of a Billy Graham effort to visit Ferguson. And he said that what you heard in the newspaper, none of that is true. He said he went there, he found that there was a very prideful community. He walked into a restaurant, he said there must have been 25 blacks, 25 whites, all talking together, all socializing. The chief of police there has the greatest respect for his community, and he did not want to leave because he feels these problems were on his watch and he wanted to solve them. So there's a tremendous community spirit there. And it turns out, according to this person, 90% of the arrests that were made were from people out of town. So what you read in the newspaper, you can't always believe. As I said, it was a frank discussion. There's certainly a recognition of the fact that most police, the majority, are great people. But there are some bad ones. And efforts need to be taken to make sure that those are dealt with. In Atlantic City, for example, it was mentioned that internal affairs, I think there was something like 475, something like that, investigations, of which there was only one adverse action taken, which sort of indicates a problem, and that problem being that blue protects blue. Maybe something needs to be done about that. But it was very good. I was happy. I was thinking of our community when I, as I sat through this, obviously. And I know that the county recently had a meeting on that. Is that right? I believe our folks attended. And I certainly want to talk to the chief about what we're doing here. And perhaps he'll tell us at some future date the results of that meeting and what we are doing. But anyway, very informative, a real problem, and I hope we can make progress on it. I also attended the Atlantic City Action Now meeting at the community college, for which the meeting addressed the Angelo economics plan for the whole region and what's being done. I'd say approximately 100 people attended. Again, it was an excellent meeting. The purpose of it was to get comments and buy-in from the public. There were a lot of great comments made and a lot of problems addressed, one of which is, and Mr. Angelo himself said this, and by the way, he's done 44 extensive strategic planning, 680 strategic plans throughout the country, 44 states in the country and internationally. And one of the things he said that he notices about this area is the extreme negativism. He said if he were coming from the outside to this area, he would be very concerned about that. That is something that we, you know, as a group need to think about, to try to be more positive, to try to be, I realize that there's a lot of reason for distrust, but to try to be a little more trustful. Now, one of the things mentioned that was there was a lady there representing a consortium of investors, most of whom are Asian, probably Chinese, that want to invest a huge amount of money in this area. They were talking about buying all of Bader Field and building a facility on Bader Field, which would be 10 million square feet, would have 1,000, this is an international trade and design center, by the way. There are other centers like that. There was one built in Hong Kong, which is 40 million square feet. They would like to build one in the United States, and they'd like to build one in Atlantic City. Atlantic City has a lot of amenities. The people that attend these things like to, in some cases, like to gamble. They certainly like to entertain. And Atlantic City has those facilities. In addition, it's near New York City. And a lot of the people that use this facility would be from New York City. They're talking about investing $4 to $5 billion. They're talking about hiring 50,000 people. They're talking about buying up foreclosed properties. I mean, that's one of the advantages of this area right now. It's got many foreclosed properties. They're talking about buying up most of those properties and, of course, building a lot more. When I heard that, I asked the lady if I could get her card, and subsequent to that, on the phone, we talked. I mentioned the Atlantic City racetrack, and that does not meet their requirements, but it can be an excellent facility for warehousing. I mentioned our industrial park, and again, that could be a facility for warehousing. She's aware of them. I might tell you that Connecticut, the Foxborough people, or whatever they are, Foxwoods, they are offering free land, and they're really trying to get this group. Las Vegas, now they made an offer to Las Vegas to buy a trade center there. It wasn't accepted, but they're still working with them. However, Las Vegas is not where they want to go. They ultimately want to go to Atlantic City, and then they could take their people to Las Vegas if they wanted to go. But we have advantages in Atlantic City. It sounded like a great opportunity, and I asked her if she would be amenable to coming here if there's interest, and for maybe a 15-minute presentation on what this is about. Now, the clock is ticking. Atlanta, Georgia is giving them land. Philadelphia is after them, and they're going to give them land. But their preference, as I understand it, would be for here, provided we act. So I thought just in the idea of keeping people informed here about what's going on, that it might be a good idea to have her come and spend 15 minutes telling us what it's about. There are three other proposals for Bader Field. The Atlantic City, well, actually, it's the governor that's going to make the decision because it's out of Atlantic City's hands. And I think we all ought to be concerned about whether the decision that's made is in our favor. Atlantic City, for example, I'm told, wants money. I'm sure this place, they have offers for free land, and they probably don't want to pay that much for Atlantic City. I understand they're talking potentially hundreds of millions, and they possibly just want to hold off, lease the land until property values improve. And that may be fine for Atlantic City, but this affects the whole area. And something that provided that many jobs would be a benefit to us too. And so I'd like people to know about it. And certainly if any decision is made by the state that benefits North Jersey, at least people here are aware of it and can follow what's going on. So if there's interest in having a maybe a 15-minute presentation, she has agreed to come and do that.
I'd more like to escort her around for 15 minutes, let her see what she would be positively impacting if they chose Atlantic City and how it would impact the surrounding communities, so, or what we have to offer, and you know, how we would be a beneficiary. But
yeah, well, this is not a proposed site for the facility.
No, you know, I understand it's going to Atlantic City, but as you said, it affects the entire region. So I'd rather drive her around and let her see what a positive impact it could have.
We can
do that too. But I'm suggesting that the township people that attend here have an opportunity to hear what's being proposed, so at least they're aware of it.
Nothing that was in the paper about it, was it?
No, part of this is being kept quiet, because you know they're still negotiating. So
interesting.
So you just unleashed it.
Well, the person has permission to. They've gotten permission to do this, but you haven't heard much about it because it's right in the process. The people supporting this want it done now. They're accustomed to getting things done fast, and this area has already dragged their feet quite a bit. So it might be helpful if people at least were aware of what was going on.
I was going to say I was with Rodney too, and the fellow that was the head of the Atlanta County Act now, Mr. Angelo. Wants everyone to take the survey. There's a survey, if you go online, it's Atlanta County
board.
Act Now.
It's on our board out front. We had
it.
Oh,
is it?
Yep.
Yeah, I asked Lisa to add it to the electronic board. We emailed it out to all of our strategic planning community members.
Okay.
We emailed it out to all the employees. And Lisa, did we do anything else?
I didn't know we did all that.
Put it on a TV site too, didn't you?
Yeah, that's right, yes.
Well, that's great, because one of the things Mr. Angelo said was that he's gotten very little response on the survey. He expected much broader response. He compared this to Lincoln, Nebraska, where they got four times the response they've gotten here. And once again, he encourages people to be more positive and to participate. So I would certainly encourage filling out the survey.
Well, this house wasn't foreclosed on, so you know, I can understand the people's feeling. Amy? Judy, did you want
to? I just wanted to.
Okay, thank you. Good.
I just want to say something respectfully, Rodney, because it really struck a chord with me when you just said this, that conclusion to the idea that one out of 475 internal investigations in Atlantic City is that blue protects blue. And I just want to state for the record that that is not representative of my opinion. I think that might just mean that there's a lot of unfounded accusations. There could be many reasons, but I just want to state that does not represent my opinion.
Well, as I said, I thought it was a very fair presentation with the police chiefs there, with everybody there, and a great appreciation for the many good policemen that were out there. But it does seem a little strange to me, or it seems strange to many, including the police, by the way, that out of that many investigations, there was only one disciplinary action. But here, I'm not trying to disparage the police.
I understand that. I just want to state for the record that that is not my conclusion. That's all I want. I just want to make sure that is not representative of my opinion. So that's it. The other things I wanted to highlight is Roger and I, as the budget committee, have been spending a lot of time and energy on getting our budget ready for presentation and introduction to everybody, as well as Cindy, and many other members of our finance committee, Mike, of course. I think we're going to present something that we can all be proud of as committee members, but more importantly, our taxpayers can be proud of. I'm not going to give away what's going to be in that budget or not in that budget. You'll have to come see for yourself next meeting, March 16th. If you care about your taxes, you will be at that meeting to watch the budget presentation. And that is where we would also consider the introduction of what is presented. So if you want to have a say in what is presented as part of the budget, again, you should be at the meeting on March 16th. Just a reminder that there is also the Greater Egg Harbor Regional Bond Referendum vote taking place on March 10th, which is next Tuesday. And, you know, we've had a lot of chatter about local budgets and school budgets, and it's an important topic. And I think, Mr. Mayor, you should be commended, and I'm sure you'll speak of it, but be commended for the meeting that you pulled together, which included myself, the superintendents from the K-8 district and the Greater Egg district, their business administrators, our business administrator, our tax assessor, our CFO, and a couple of the school board members, not violating any sunshine laws or anything like that, but brought us all together to have a discussion about out for the taxpayer as a whole unit and not just individual boards, not just individual tax collecting entities. I think, you know, we're all very cognizant of the fact that even though we might have put ourselves in a good position financially over the years, that may not necessarily be true for the schools, and, you know, that people out there are still struggling. Our residents in particular, and we want to make sure, and I think, Mr. Mayor, you did a great job with this in making sure that the message was loud and clear that our residents and what is coming out of their pockets, it's important to us and it needs to be important to the school boards, and that we all need to be working together to mitigate and minimize that impact to our residents. And I thought it was a really, really well done session, Mayor, and again, you should be commended. Thanks, and you should comments. Be you should be pleased with the dialogue that we had at that meeting. So.
Thank you.
Thanks.
First of all, March 6th, our chief of the community will be installed as the president of the Atlantic County Police Chiefs Association. So now we have the chief of chiefs, something to look forward to. And
all hail.
All hail.
So, chief.
It's interesting when you look at budgets, because we all know it's been a struggle. And if it wasn't for the fact that 4 years ago, we bit the big bullet, we recognized at that time it was a result of the efforts of strategic planning to set a five-year plan and set the goals that we wanted to accomplish. And while it was painful at the time, I think it bore fruition, because we eliminated our structural deficit. And many of you will see when you come to our budget presentation all the highlights of the good things. And I think everyone should be able to share in it, because it's a budget that's a strong budget and something we're proud of. And that was the reason that we summoned the superintendents of the Great Egg Harbor and the mainland together, along with their business administrators and a few board members, to try to impress upon them that you've got to start looking at holding the line on taxes when and if you can, and that you too should start planning ahead. Because every time that you have a problem, the simple way of solving it is not to raise taxes. The simple way of solving it is to address it in long-term planning and how you're going to get to that conclusion, so that the issues that Rodney brought up about the number of people that are hurting. We looked at the classified section of the paper today. What was it, 20 pages?
17 pages of foreclosures.
And of course, week after week after week, it seems to be repeating. And if that isn't sending out a message of how dire things are, and you back that into the other things that Rodney talked about, that same day he attended that meeting at night, I attended one along with the chairman of the Industrial Commission and another member over at the college, and we met in a boardroom with Mr. Angelo, who's the consultant. And of course, his comments were kind of direct, but they hit the target because there is a great amount of negativism. It's very hard to get people incentivized when they lost their job, they're about to lose their house, and they don't see anything on the horizon. So pretty much he had asked the people in the room, and a lot of them were elected officials and other officials in the community, that what would you like to see in the area? And then there were various comments. But I think the core comes down to one simple thing. They have to hire somebody who's going to be a cheerleader for the area, who's going to have to incentivize everybody with positive messages. I mean, there were several realtors there too who said it's very hard to get people into the area to buy homes when everything you read is negative. And the newspapers haven't helped. I'm talking about the press. Every day you open up the press, and when's the last time you've seen a press reporter in our audience? There was a time when there was always a press reporter here who wrote about things in a positive manner. And there's a way of doing that. Now, it may sell papers when it's negative, but it also finds its way into the garbage can too. And I think that it's depressing in many ways, but I think the county's on the right path of trying to develop an economic recovery plan. And I think it's gonna take participation from everybody, from elected officials to residents to business people, because Atlantic City alone is not the answer to our problems, okay? And that's why I think Amy was even saying that this individual that wants this build in the Bader Field, I still maintain today that if Bader Field didn't have Surf Stadium and it was here in our township, and if they didn't have the skating ring, it would be here in this township. I'm talking ice skating, Judy, okay? Don't get upset, don't get upset. There would still be viable businesses, and they would be profitable, and they would be ongoing. I think we have a lot to offer where we are. We're in a prime location, and I disagree that this isn't the area because of where it is. I think it's because we're highly accessible. Black Horse, White Horse Pike, Wrangleboro Road, the expressway. I mean, where are you going to find 250 acres in any of these communities that's collected in an area like that, that offers so much opportunity for someone who can invest and will invest? And I think you may see that happening in time. So I think the long and the short of it is that when we present our budget, we have the resident in mind, totally in mind, and you'll see that. So with that, I'll open it up to the public.
Can I just make a brief, there is a meeting on March 5th from 5 to 7 at the Atlantic City Council Chambers. It's open to the public. The subject is Bader Field and Garden and Basin. For anyone that's interested, that's where they're gonna talk about number of plans for those areas. And it does affect us.
Thank you, Rodney. I'll open up to the public. James?
I'd like to thank the Township Committee for introducing our ordinance tonight. John and I have been working on it for the past couple of years, including earlier this year. John must have been getting tired of my calls. Because one time I called him twice in one day with because I had so many questions about the ordinance.
Well, your work is just beginning. Just beginning, Jim.
First Monday in April, by the way, is April 6th, which happens to be the Easter Monday.
Good.
Day after Easter.
Good.
Rodney, I couldn't make it to ACC Thursday night because I was ill.
Oh, all right. Well, sorry about that. You can make this meeting, maybe.
I still got a cold. I'm not 100% yet.
All right. Well, you get better, and then when you can make some of them, okay? Thank you for your comments. Anyone else?
Hopefully on April 6th, that will be the final step.
That's okay, great. Jim. Thanks, Jim. Jim. Anyone else?
Did Mark have it?
Mr. Angelo?
Not the Angelo that's been doing all this work, huh?
I was hoping I could take some credit.
the Mays Landing Athletic Association is going to hold one more sign up for softball and baseball this Thursday at the library. The reason we're doing it is baseball and softball does not have have enough kids right now to round out the teams.
Wow.
So,
wow.
Like, in a situation with softball at the ages of 10, 12, and 16, we have 19 girls in each. What do you do with that? So we're trying to get at least 3 to 5 more girls at each age level to round out the team. So we are having one more sign up. Baseball's having the same issues as well. A lot of girls are just playing soccer or travel, or some people are unaware that we are having signups, even though we've been doing it for 4 weeks. They're just not aware. So we already have one more sign up. That's Thursday night from 6 to 7:30 at the Mays Landing Library.
Is the weather a factor possibly for the lack of signups?
No. Last year, I guess baseball did about 300 kids. This year, they're probably down 80.
Wow.
Wow.
Softball's only down about 20. But softball doesn't get nearly the turnout baseball does. But collectively, you know, it affects our budgets and how we operate when we don't have the kids playing. We still have to pay for uniforms. We still have all the same things we have to work for, and you can understand that. So anyway, we're just looking to get some more kids out Thursday, parents to come sign up. So make the announcement here. If anybody knows anybody, Amy, I know you shared it on Facebook.
I'm doing it right now again as we speak. Can you give me the date and time again?
Yeah, it's Thursday from 6 to 7:30. We have a Facebook page, Mays Landing Softball, and then you also have Mays Landing Baseball. So you can find it on Facebook, you can share it on your page, and maybe you'll find somebody who wasn't aware. Okay, I think something that holds people back too. As a recreational league, you do not have to have experience in playing that sport. You could be 15 years old, never played baseball before or softball, and you come on. Everybody makes a team. So I think there's a misconception there when parents, when their kids get a little bit older, they don't think about putting them into one of these leagues because they've never played before. And we're also taking kids up 5 years old into softball now as well. So for girls that want to play baseball, not necessarily baseball because you only have t-ball, we now also offer softball at that age. So that's it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
Cheryl?
Thanks.
Thank you for getting the ordinance introduced. But now I tell you about something with the Historic Society. We're running a bus trip to Washington, D.C.
I saw that.
So if you want to put it on Facebook for me, I'd appreciate it, Amy.
Did you put it?
Yeah, did you send a request in for the sign?
Huh? Oh, it's already on the sign.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Good. Anyone else in the audience?
Move to close the public portion.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion. Okay. With that, item number 12 is adjourned to executive session. Mrs. Anderson.
Okay. Be resolved by the Township Committee of the Township of Hamilton that this meeting be adjourned to an executive session to discuss personnel. Item A, finance clerk. Item B, maintenance carpenter. And collective bargaining with the lieutenants. Be it further resolved, the Township Committee of the Township of Hamilton will reconvene in public session and confirm the results of the executive session if there's a majority consensus for action to be taken on the matters tonight.
So moved.
Second.
Motion to second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So we'll adjourn to the other room.
On the record, Ms. Sampson?
Yeah.
Okay, the time now is 9:13. We are back in the open session, having gone into executive session. The only subject matters discussed in the executive session were those that were announced prior to going back in, the minutes of which will be made available at which time the confidential nature of the matter discussed is no longer confidential. We had our staff walk outside in the lobby and out front to ascertain whether or not there was any public out there that might be interested, because it was announced that we would come back into public session and could take action. There are, in fact, 3 folks here, and you may proceed, Mr. Mayor.
Yes, We're back in executive session. Do we have the...
We're back in public session.
Public session.
I make a motion to terminate the two positions as discussed and post, and also to post for backfill of each position.
One at a time.
Oh, one at a time, sorry. All right, I make a motion to terminate the position in the finance office and post to backfill.
Thank you.
Have a...
A second.
Motion is second. Any other questions or comments? Roll call, Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Make a motion to terminate the position in the Public Works Department and post to backfill.
I'll second that.
Motion is second. Any other questions or comments? Mrs. Anderson.
Ms. Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mrs. Link?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.